Welcome to Creation Magazine Live, and this is a program where we take articles from Creation Magazine and we discuss them and encourage you to get to the website, creation.com. You can look up the whole article. Oftentimes there's links at the end there where there's additional information. You can kind of cross-reference some of the things that are referenced in the article, so get to creation.com. Now, today you've chosen obviously a very relevant to the Christian faith
topic. One that
topic.
We talked about when it went up online, the day that this article went up online, you and I were talking about how we can explain to pastors the relevance of having a CMI speaker come in
right.
and address the congregation on something like a Sunday morning or for the main service.
Yes.
And the website on that particular day was running this article that we're going to read through here. Fast octopus fossils reveal no evolution.
Right.
And we thought, you put yourself in the pastor's shoes. And you say, oh yeah, Creation Ministries, we should have a speaker into our church. Let's go to their website and check out who these guys are.
Right.
Click creation.com. Fast. What does that have to do with strengthening my church? And
what does that have to do with the gospel? What does that have to do with what Jesus taught? What does that have to do with how I'm going to live my life as a Christian, right? That's the comment I was making. If you'd never been to our website before and you pop this website up and it says, Fast Octopus Fossil Reveals No Evolution, you know, would you make the connection to what our ministry is all about? So
that's the concern, that the connection is made between, okay, well, why is a Christian ministry, why do we employ PhD scientists, for example? That's the first thing. Why bother with science?
What does fossilization have to do with the gospel?
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. So anyway, so sometimes we need to make those connections, and that's why we have speakers go to churches.
Yes, and it's about building faith and so on, and there's two main points to this article here, and we'll just go through it. Five octopus fossils, supposedly 95 million years old, were recently discovered in Lebanon, catching scientists by surprise. First, they were surprised that the octopuses were even fossilized.
Right.
Unlike animals with hard shells or bony skeletons, cephalopods like octopus and squid have no hard parts other than the mouth. One report said that fossilizing an octopus was as unlikely as capturing, or here's the quote, a fossil sneeze. So you can understand this, right? How can something made only of soft tissue be preserved in deposited mud? It's going to rot. It's not.
Right. And many people have the idea that fossilization is a process that takes a long time to occur. Stone, you know, it takes a long time for these layers to actually, you know, become
slowly buried and so on. Obviously, if it was slowly buried, you'd have nothing left.
Right.
The fossils were exquisitely preserved. All eight arms were visible for each animal, as well as traces of muscles and rows of suckers. Remarkably, a few of the fossils even showed internal gills and remnants of ink.
Wow.
Scientists try to explain the past by looking at what they see happening today. When an octopus dies, it decomposes into a slimy blob and disappears within a few days. It's a pretty picture.
That's what happens at the hockey games, right? When they... Oh, yeah. We won't mention that.
That's Canada here.
Canada, sorry.
Inside joke. For an octopus to be fossilized, it would need to sink to the ocean floor without being eaten, remain there without decomposing or being consumed by bacteria, while being buried by sediment. How could such a process be possible for an octopus at all?
Right.
Lead author of the report, Dr. Dirk Fuchs from Free University in Berlin, said, "The luck was that the corpse landed untouched on the seafloor. The seafloor was free of oxygen and therefore free of scavengers," end quote. But lack of oxygen is no preservative. Experiments with fish carcasses show that even in the absence of oxygen, they still disintegrate on the ocean bottom.
Right.
Other scientists have published research showing that the ocean floor is actually teeming with bacterial life. So these scientists have not explained the remarkable preserved fossils at all.
Right.
The second surprise, that's the first surprise.
Just the fact that you've got fossil octopuses.
Exactly.
They rot very quickly.
The second surprise was that the specimens look very much like modern species of octopus.
Right.
Quote, "These things are 95 million years old, yet one of the fossils is almost indistinguishable from living species," end quote.
Right. So again, we actually did an episode of Creation Magazine Live talking about evolutionary stasis, which is exactly what this is. What it really means, no evolution. Because there's no change.
Yes.
They look at, if you haven't evolved in 95 million years, you're not evolving.
That's the surprise.
Right.
Yes. Evolutionary thinking predicts that an octopus as old as these should look much more primitive, since evolution requires increasing complexity over time. Evolutionists have always assumed that the ancient octopus would show very primitive features, but this discovery, quote, pushes back the origin, the origins of modern octopus by tens of millions of years.
Right.
So you hear this in evolutionary circles all the time.
All
Here's
the
a new
time.
Discovery. Oh, we need to rethink the whole evolution of this, or
right.
the, how this happened, and so on. Every new discovery seems to not fit with evolution,
but because
and need
of
to modify
the
it.
Fact that this is not operational science, this is not an experiment you're setting up in a lab and observing today. You're making a hypothesis about what happened in the past.
It's the old octopi.
It's so fluid. You could just say, "Oh, well, let's move that back another 10 million years," because the 10 million years aren't something you're actually tangibly holding on to. You just
and
push it back, and then it works, and you carry on with your.
Yeah.
Your theory, right?
What's remarkable, or I guess what we should point out, is that the story of evolution is so fluid.
Of course.
It doesn't really have much explanatory power then, does it? If you have the story of evolution, and every discovery that is made,
many
of the discoveries that are made, we need to modify it. We need to modify it again. If it needs to be modified
I've had a skeptic say that was one of the weak points of what a creationist believes, because we actually have a timeline, we have a history, we have a written, chronology, a document that we adhere to. And they say, well, that's one of your biggest weaknesses, because you guys are actually saying that this is how it happened. We're just saying overall this is how it happened, and we can just change it around anyway.
One of the strengths of any scientific model is its ability to explain phenomena. It's explanatory power.
Right.
We have a model that says there was a point in history, 4,000 to 5,000 years ago,
yep.
where the world was covered with water. There was
right.
a global flood.
And what would you expect to find in a catastrophe like that when we look at flood-like conditions today?
Yes. Yeah. Marine fossils buried, massive geologic features on a not just regional but continent and even global scale.
Sediment build up very, very quickly in these types of situations, which would bury
animals like octopus buried quickly.
Right.
And many of these discoveries, we look at the discovery. Oh, here's a new discovery. Here's these five octopus fossils, remarkably preserved, and they look just like octopus today. I'm okay with that.
It fits with
that rigid creation model that we get, of course, from Scripture.
Yep.
You have that history there and the timeline. These things are not millions of years old. That
right.
fits with the creation model,
yep.
right from the Bible. And they were buried quickly. That's exactly what a flood
right.
would do.
So you read an article like this, and again, we started talking about, well, what does this have to do with my faith or anything like that? Because, look at what it's saying. When you look at what the Bible says, it says it was a global flood. It said God created in 6 days, a very, very short period of time ago, about 6,000 years ago. What does it take to actually make a fossil? Right? Can you really do it slowly, or does it have to be done quickly? You need to bury it in a lot of sediment. Everything here is screaming that the Bible's history is true. Well, if the Bible's history is true, there was no death before Adam sinned. Jesus came to be the last Adam to pay the penalty what the first Adam
right,
brought in.
Exactly.
Everything just points to the fact that you can just trust the Bible plainly. You don't have to go with some secular interpretation or reinterpret the Bible. That's what the magazine's all about. So sometimes people don't get it, but really that's the main thrust of
yes.
what we're talking about.